morning. This is Pastor Cary Rodgers here to give you your morning manna. I pray that you're doing well this morning, and I am fired up to be on the air with you today to share the word of truth for such a time that we're living in right now. Who needs hope, my friend? We all need hope, and Satan is doing all he can to try to stop this work, but Satan won't stop it. Because God is in control, amen? And let's stay faithful to God for such a time as this. But let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the word of truth. We thank you for a brand new morning. We thank you, Lord, for your love, your hope. We thank you so much for the plan of salvation. We thank you, Lord, for the blood of Jesus Christ that covers us from all sin. And we thank you, Lord, for the everlasting covenant. We thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And we ask you, Lord, to lead us in our study today, a very important topic today, and just shows your character in its totality. So we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today's title is Aggressive Love. Aggressive Love. And we're going to show you that Jesus, throughout the Word of God, shows us his aggressive love for us. We don't deserve it, Lord. We don't deserve it. But we just thank the Lord for his aggressive love. So let's talk about his aggressive love. And this is part one. Tomorrow we look at part two. As a crowd of publicans and sinners gathered round about Jesus, what did the Pharisees and the scribes say to each other to show their displeasure to Jesus? Let's go to Luke 15, 1 through 2. That's Luke 15, 1 and 2. Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. We're talking about Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, "This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them." Now, who were the Pharisees and the scribes? Let's talk about them and see who they were all about. Now, the Pharisees were the church leadership who were known to be, quote unquote, holy, but they weren't really holy, but they act like they were holy. They were given the name by the Sadducees to mock them how they separated themselves from the common people because they thought that they were so holy. The Pharisees did not mingle themselves with those who they deemed were corrupt or filthy. Now, many of the scribes were historians, interpreters of the scriptures, and policymakers of the church. Now, who are the publicans and sinners? Well, publicans were Jewish tax collectors for the Roman Empire. It was a profession that paid very well, and many of the Jews, especially the church leadership, saw all publicans as betrayers. They were greatly hated and despised. Sinners were a category of people who had no status in the Jewish church. They were nobodies, many uneducated and poor. The Pharisees viewed their poverty and lack of social status. They saw it was a curse from God. So now you kind of got an idea when it comes to the Pharisees and the scribes and the publicans and what they were all about. Now, what was the Pharisees' false teaching about the publican and sinners? Let's go ahead and look at it. The Pharisees saw the publicans and the sinners' cases as hopeless. They saw them as not worthy of being in their holy presence, quote unquote. That's how much the Pharisees were puffed up about themselves. Remember the prayer of the Pharisee in Jesus' parable, Luke 18, 11 and 12. Let's look at it again. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus within himself, "God, I thank thee that I am not as other men, are extortioners, unjust, adulterers, and even as this publican. I fast twice in the week and give tithes and all I possess." I'm going to go to Christ Object Lessons, page 189 by Ellen White concerning this. It was taught by the Jews that before God's love was extended to a sinner, he must first repent. In their view, repentance was a work which men earn the favor of heaven. And it was this thought that led the Pharisees to exclaim the astonishment and anger. And this man receiveth sinners. Again, that was Christ's Object Lessons, page 189. The Pharisees and the scribes truly thought that their education, status, position, and heredity and righteousness gave them favor with God. Because of their privilege, wealth, and status, they believed that they were very blessed by God. In modern day Christianity, many see themselves privileged and blessed by God because of their status and wealth, same like they did with the Pharisees. They, like the Laodicean church says, Revelation 3:17, I'm rich, I'm increased with goods, and I have need of nothing. I got everything I need. That's what they say, the church of Laodicea. What were the Pharisees trying to accuse Jesus of? And what was their motive in their accusation? And when they murmured to Jesus, receiveth sinners and eateth with them. Now, the Thayer's definition of murmur, according to the Greek, means either of a whole crowd or among one another. Always used of many indignantly complaining. You got it, you didn't miss it. They did not address Jesus directly. And that's what murmur is really all about. They complained among themselves and others to try to discredit Jesus. They were gossipers. And does that go on today, my friend, even within the church? Yes, it goes on a lot. The gossip. The purpose of the gossiper is to lift up themselves and discredit and assassinate the character of others. And I'm going to read from Christ's Object Lessons, page 185, because this is a big problem in the church. And even those who call themselves, quote unquote, present truth, this whole issue of just gossiping on people is it's not good. The Bible says it's the gospel, not the gossipers. It's not the good news of gossip. But that's what like a lot of people like. Oh, give me the good news. What's the good news? Well, it's no good news about gossip. The whole purpose is to lift up self, discredit, and assassinate the character of others. Christ Object Lessons, page 185, talks about this. Let's see what it says. By this accusation that Jesus received sinners, they insinuated that Christ linked to associate with sinful and vile and was insensible to their wickedness. The rabbis had been disappointed in Jesus. Why was it that one who claimed so lofty a character did not mingle with them and follow their methods of teaching? Why did he go about so unpretendingly, working among all classes? If he were a true prophet, they said, he would harmonize with them and would treat the publicans and sinners with indifference they deserved. In anger, these guardians of society, that he with whom they were continually in controversy, yet whose purity of life awed and condemned them, should meet in such apparent sympathy with social outcasts. They did not approve of his methods. They regarded themselves as educated, refined, and preeminently religious. But Christ's example laid bare their selfishness, their pride. I add that part. And they were nothing but a group of gossipers. What does the Bible say about the main purpose of Jesus? Well, Jesus came to save sinners, my friend. Matthew 1:21 says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. And then it says in 1 Timothy 1:15, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. So Jesus didn't come to entertain. He came to save us from sin. Amen. Now, what was Jesus' reply to the Pharisees and the scribes when they made the same type of accusations before? Let's go to Luke 5:30-32. That's Luke 5:30-32. But their scribes and Pharisees murmured against the disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with the publicans and sinners?" And Jesus answering, saying to them, "They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. And I came not to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance." Who are sinners? Romans 3:23 says, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." So all, even the self-righteous, like the Pharisees, did not recognize themselves as a need of repentance. So all who have self-righteousness like the Pharisees, they do not recognize themselves as need of repentance. So why did Jesus come to save sinners? Why did Jesus come to save sinners? One of the most famous texts in this world, in the Bible, John 3:16-17. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, and whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have what, my friend? Everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And now let's go to 1 John 4:9-10. 1 John 4:9-10. "In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent not his only begotten son into the world that he might live through him." Herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be a propitiation for our sin. And my friend, this is real love. Remember, today we're talking about aggressive love, and we're going to see more of that in display as we continue our study. This is real love. The ministry of Jesus is a manifestation of God's love. This is not based on sentimentalism or feeling, but the principles of God's character found in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We can find that in 1 Corinthians 13:4-7. Charity is love. Same thing as love. Charity suffers long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity is vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. It rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. It beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, and endureth all things. So I want you to think about this. See, Jesus' love for us is so deep. To save us, he literally gave his life. Let me repeat that again. Jesus' love for us is so deep. To save us, he literally gave his life. See, this is an aggressive, tenacious love. Amen. An aggressive love that moves with power to break through and endure any obstacle to save us. Aggressive love is conditional love. Somebody say, "I thought it was unconditional." Well, Jesus had to die on a cross. His blood had to be spilled for us. That's conditional. So in order to redeem us and save us, a condition of salvation, a contract, had to be fulfilled, and that is death. The price for our souls is death. Jesus paid it with his life to fulfill the contract. See, Jesus' aggressive love does not excuse sin, but saves us from it. Now, how does Jesus illustrate the deep, aggressive love that he has for every single person, including you and I, my friend? Well, we find that in Luke chapter 15, while the Pharisees and the scribes were murmuring, complaining about Jesus eating with the publicans and sinners, Jesus lifts up his voice and gives three powerful parables that illustrates his aggressive love for every person. Listen, my friend, this is beautiful. Three powerful aggressive love parables. That is the lost sheep, the lost silver coin, and the prodigal son. Well, we won't go over the prodigal son because we studied the prodigal son last time we were with you. Now, what is the first aggressive love parable that Jesus gives in Luke 15? Let's take a look at it. Luke 15:3-7. Luke 15:3-7. "And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when they have found it, he layeth on his shoulders rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying to him, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost. And I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. At the time of Christ, raising sheep was a major part of the Jewish economy. Every sheep was extremely valuable. Sheep were very docile, timid creatures. They totally depended on their shepherd for survival. They depended on their shepherd for protection from the natural predators such as wolves. So wandering sheep, let's talk about that. So from time to time, a sheep would go from grazing one pasture to another, wanders away from the flock of the sheep. Sometimes they are distracted or lured away from the flock without the shepherd's notice. And after the shepherd rounds up the flock and he takes account of all those that's there, he notices that one sheep is missing. Now, after other sheep are secure, he goes on his search and rescue mission of the lost sheep. The shepherd searches and searches high and low for the lost sheep. He climbs hills and mountains. He aggressively pushes way through thorns and thickets. From time to time, he was cut and bruised by the jagged rocks and sharp thorns. He has no time to attend to his wounds. His thoughts are only on that lost sheep. From a distance, he hears the cry of the lost sheep, "Baa, baa." The shepherd gets excited, only thinking of the lost sheep. As he gets closer to the cry, he looks down off the distance. He sees the sheep is stuck in the thicket down a deep, narrow ravine in between two mountains. He aggressively makes his way down the steep ravine. As he gets closer and closer, the sound of the sheep starts to fade. The sheep is starting to lose its energy. The sheep is fighting so hard to free himself, but now he's running out of energy. In addition to that, the sheep is bleeding from the terrible fall he took down the ravine. His vital forces, his vital energy is gradually fading. The sheep is about to die. The shepherd sees and hears this and moves more aggressively to his lost sheep. He pushes away the stone. He pushes away the rock. He pushes away the thick brush. At last, he makes it to the lost sheep. He binds up the sheep's wounds and gives him water and food to the sheep. And then he puts the sheep on his shoulders and aggressively makes his way up the ravine, through the thicket, and the thorns back to the flock. As he nears the flock, he is rejoicing and singing about a sheep that was once lost, but now found. And when he brings the whole flock back to the village, he gathers his family and his friends and rejoice that he found his precious sheep. And we're going to leave it right there, my friend, and we're going to continue on tomorrow about aggressive love. We'll conclude this tomorrow. So make sure you join us again on the same great and blessed station tomorrow, my friend, in the morning, Morning Manna. Let us pray. Dear Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for your truth. We thank you, Lord, for your aggressive love. And many of us were lost sheep with no hope. But Lord, you gave us hope. And we thank you, Lord, for your word, because your word is the only thing that gives us hope. And so, Lord, it increases our faith. And the Bible says it's the word that sanctifies us. So, Lord, maybe just continue in your word and just stay faithful to your truth to the end of time. You said in your word, those that endure to the end shall be saved. And Lord, we just pray that it's us. Because, Lord, this world is crooked. It's a sick world. It is so many. It's a violent world. And, Lord, we want to be part of a better place. So, Lord, help us to make it. And then help us help others to make it to the kingdom of God by sharing the word of truth to them. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, my friend, gotta go. You'll hear from me tomorrow on this station right here. So make sure you join us again tomorrow, same time, same place. May God bless you and Maranatha. For those who want to do the medical missionary work and be trained, go to bcmeonline.org. Go to bcmeonline.org and you, your family, and friends will be tremendously, greatly blessed by the training. Be blessed.